Hi, my name is Peebs, and I have never listened to a Lana Del Rey song. In some circles, never listening to Lana Del Rey, especially never even trying a taste of her semi-psychedelic alt-rock album Ultraviolence, is sacrilege. Don't get me wrong, it's not like my music taste ever lingered far from her work. One of my all-time favorite albums is by one of Lana's closest contemporaries, Electroheart by Marina Sands the Diamonds. Lana, how I hate those guys! However, during the lead-up to Ultraviolence, which is now almost 10 years old, much of what I'd heard about Lana Del Rey and of her music are criticisms still levied against her to this day. Mainly the ones that she's touting anti-feminist rhetoric and has a slight misogynistic aesthetic to her work. So, to challenge my taste, with an open mind and open ears, I'm finally listening to Lana Del Rey, starting with her second album, Ultraviolence. Here is an honest review from someone listening to it for the first time. Ultraviolence certainly starts strong with the track Cruel World, which has this excellent desert rock guitar that paints a picture of this album's atmosphere, and lyrically, it also introduces a lot of the major themes of this album, with Lana lamenting in idolic reverence towards toxic men. A lot of people back in the day criticized Lana for romanticizing abusive relationships and controlling men, but more often than not, the instrumentation, at least off this album, makes these stories sound tragic, not idealized. For example, with the use of strings off the titular track, Ultraviolence. But, speaking of Ultraviolence, it's one of several tracks where, ultimately, there's a catchy chorus surrounded by unnoteworthy fluff. Frequently, the verses on these songs are forgettable and borderline amateur in their lyrics. I mean, the Ultraviolence song begins with, "He used to call me DN, that stood for Deadly Nightshade, 'cause I was filled with poison, but blessed with beauty and rage." That "and rage" part two shows not only her lyrics, but often her singing is clunky and stressed in ways against how you'd naturally deliver the words. "We could go back to New York. We could go back to New York. The song West Coast, the only track I was tangentially familiar with coming into this album, is completely unnoteworthy except for, again, an extremely catchy chorus. Well, admittedly, I also like the part that comes just before the chorus, where the beat slows down with that boom 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 boom. Honestly, most of my problems with this record, I'm sorry to say, come down to Lana herself. Her baby doll singing style on tracks like Pretty When You Cry finally give me a direct reference for that "Welcome to My Kitchen" vine. Do you remember that one?
"We have bananas and avocado."
Like, especially Pretty When You Cry. Her vocals on the verse, sonically akin to two balloons squeaking against each other, taint an otherwise exceptional blues rock instrumental. And Sad Girl.
Crickets. Crickets.
Sad Girl's lyrics were a real low point for this album, and honestly, I have no doubt that even Lana's most stalwart fans don't hold that track to the highest regard. This isn't to say Lana always falters on Ultraviolence, though. As I said, I really enjoyed its opener, Cruel World, and a lot of the early tracks on this album are some of Lana's best performances. Shades of Cool is particularly impressive. I mean, She's not winning any Poet Laureate awards anytime soon, but I still enjoyed the back-and-forth story of her wanting to fix this man she's one of many for, a man she equally acknowledges is unfixable. Her high notes definitely benefit from that echoing effect added in the final mix, sure, but ultimately that still leads to a great vocal performance, and Jesus Christ, that guitar solo in the bridge. Another one of the early tracks, Brooklyn Baby, comes up right after Shades of Cool, and is one of the more up-tempo and overall catchy tracks on Ultraviolence. It also is one of the stronger examples of Lana's songwriting. While those aforementioned clunky verses are present as they ever are, it sort of works in this song's favor. It's from this perspective of like a high school junior dating a college sophomore, thinking she's far more mature than she actually is, based off superficial things like singing Lou Reed or smoking weed. Even how she sings, "I can play most anything," sounds like she's saying it with a desperate to prove herself smile. And then the final refrain of the chorus, underscored by the deep, rich Appalachian voice of Seth Kaufman, a fellow North Carolinian, shout out. It's one of the most beautiful parts of this album. I will say, my first listen, Brooklyn Baby had me verbally and physically cringe with the "talking about that new nation." Oh. Also, I suspect this is one of the songs that got Lana those claims of her supporting Lolita fetish stuff, but I also know on her first album she literally has a track called Lolita. Here, if that's the case for Brooklyn Baby, I don't see it. If anything, there's a twist of dark humor I actually appreciate. And while not as strong, Lana shows that twisted humor on later tracks like Fucked My Way Up to the Top and Money, Power, Glory, though upon first listens, I don't think it translates as well. The former, melodically, is the plainest track off Ultraviolence, and the latter, Money, Power, Glory, I don't think executes the satire Lana was aiming for. It's a song supposed to be in direct response to the criticisms of her romanticizing toxic feminine imagery, in this case her playing as a gold-digging user, but I struggle to see the satirization in its lyrics. Plus, it's one of the songs on this album that over-relies on harmonies and vocal stackings that really puts me off from actually enjoying it. I heard there's a rumored remix to Money, Power, Glory locked away in the Lana vault somewhere, and personally, I would like to see this track revisited because potential is there. I think potential is actually potent to enjoying Ultraviolence because moments that are supposed to be some of the greatest on the record are, if not soured by questionable lyrics and or singing, are tainted by some bad mixing. For example, to revisit the titular track Ultraviolence, there's this call and response round to the final refrain of the chorus that you may not have even heard depending on how you're listening to the record, drowned out in part because it's in more of Lana's baby doll singing, but also because it wasn't balanced correctly. This particular mixing issue is such a problem to me because that round underscoring the Ultraviolence outro has its words returned to later open a track, but you might not have even known that because of how it's mixed. And even if you did, honestly, I couldn't tell you why they were brought back. Just reusing words for the sake of reusing them. The album's deluxe tracks, Black Beauty, Guns N' Roses, and Florida Kilos, are equally a mixed bag as the rest of the record. Florida Kilos is the brightest sounding track on Ultraviolence, which makes a case where I would say those claims of Lana romanticizing bad behavior, here being cocaine abuse, aren't entirely unjustified. And then there's Black Beauty, which isn't a song I'd skip, but is ultimately forgettable. At least Guns N' Roses makes use of Lana's vocal stacks and harmonies, allowing them to complement the swelling electric guitar slowly building through the song's duration. She sounds great there. And fortunately, she sounds great as the album closes as well. Old Money is a beautiful, cinematic string and piano ballad that not only has great Lana vocals, but great lyrics as well. My father's love was always strong, my mother's glamour lives on and on, yet still inside I feel alone, for reasons unknown to me. Ugh! It's great, a much-needed hint of sunshine and vulnerability in the otherwise dark and stormy atmosphere of Ultraviolence. The actual closer, The Other Woman, wraps up many of this album's themes on femininity and infidelity in a nice little bow. Lana's voice has this grainy effect on it that sounds like she's being played on an old radio or she's singing sad karaoke at a podunk bar. It's really nice. I do question what it means that these two closing tracks aren't entirely original Lana works. Old Money borrows the melody off the 1968 Romeo and Juliet movie.
What is a youth? Impetuous fire.
Those summer nights seem long ago.
And The Other Woman is straight up a Nina Simone cover. By the end of my time with Ultraviolence, I came away with an appreciation for its vision more than anything. Aesthetically, the ingredients are all there. The sound, a fusion of desert rock, classic rock, and psych rock, creating the atmosphere of tragic 70s-inspired vignettes of, frankly, women, and the abuse thereof. I see where Lana's head was at, but if not fluffed up by needless filler or sabotaged by questionable production decisions, often this record falls flat because of Lana Del Rey herself. At the end of the day, I would say this album is like a 5. 5.5, maybe. Should I listen to more of Lana Del Rey? I hope that her career, her work, especially her vocals, only improve. I mean, everyone was raving about Ocean Boulevard for good reason, right? Thank you so much for watching. This was honestly a lot of fun to do. I'm one of those people who just never seems to get around to that classic piece of media that everyone else has because I was such a hipster growing up. So I hope that a first opinion from someone who's only seen or listened to something in this case so far after its release makes for entertaining content. Now, do all those things you're supposed to do. Leave a like, a comment, subscribe. If you do subscribe, I would highly suggest putting on that notification bell because look how frequent my upload schedule is.
Ew!
For now, I'm Peebs, America's loudest introvert, signing off.